Yeah, something's fucked up. It's not going to the stream.
Oh, it's not showing your audio?
No. No, it's not. It's not live.
No, it's live. It says so right here. Live for almost a minute.
Oh, shit. Oh, well, I guess my phone is. All right. Hey, everybody. A little jacked up. All right.
One and all.
Ahoy. All right.
A.C. Pritchard.
Well, what up?
Welcome aboard. Join us.
Where to,
while
Captain?
We sail the iron seas. Yeah. All right. Today, we're joined as always with myself, the ultimate Kahuna, and A.C. Pritchard. Tonight, we're going to be talking about some stuff. Concerning some stuff about a little bit, getting a little conservative media type stuff. Maybe a little bit. What was it?
Conservative media. Kahuna's
more. Kahuna's more. What was the other thing we're going to talk about, guys?
So there's only one question in regards to Kahuna's. Clean or jungle? No.
Who's jungle?
There's situations for both, actually, too, I think.
I need the jungle just for when I fall. I need a cushion down there. Don't want to lose something, you know what I'm saying?
Insulation, depending on what region you live in, you know?
So the other thing we're going to talk, well, we're going to do some introductions, but we're also going to talk a little bit about sweet baby ink and how that kind of ties into some of the book stuff, maybe. And then also some stuff about the toxicity ratings. But first, let's talk introductions. Kahuna, you first. How'd you get started? How'd you get here, I guess?
How'd I get here? Well, in 1993, my father met my mother. No. I was making videos when I was a little kid. Me and my siblings and friends, we put together all these WWE, like fake wrestling Raw style kind of videos when we were kids, and assassination movies and such that when I was very young, and always thought it'd be fun to get into YouTube and do that. But then I got older, got busy, and it never happened. And last year I made this channel because I had felt like I had something to say and wanted to start making content, you know, can't let this blooming personality go to waste. And so here we
are. Not. Right. All right, Pritchard, what about you, man?
Well, I been writing basically my whole life. Got inspired from like games and movies and what have you, other books and all that. Started writing in high school and became a movie review columnist and like just a general journalist for like sports and stuff, because for my local newspaper. Did that for a little bit, moved on to music, did that for like a decade, got out of that. Always wanted to be an author, so here I am now. Got a book on Amazon and free stuff on Substack. So glad to be here. Glad to talk about like culture and storytelling. And whatever else you guys want, I'm ready to go.
Cool, cool. All right. Hey guys, don't forget to like and subscribe, of course. Hey, about myself, I guess. So I was in the military after high school. We'll back up a little bit. I didn't read any books because I'm pretty much dyslexic.
Makes that harder.
Yeah, I just watched a lot of movies religiously, TV and everything like that. Went to the military, did my thing for 8 years. It came out, and I don't know, just something kind of hit me. I think it was probably a combination of Game of Thrones just crashing and then Star Wars crashing, and I just kind of had a little inspiration to write. Wrote my book, Planet of Babel, if you can see it a little bit. Dawn Edge.
Hell yeah, brother.
Available on Amazon. I think I have all of our links for things to buy, where to watch us, where to sub in the description. And I got another book on the way and kind of getting to YouTube because I feel like that might be the best way to advertise a book or something. I enjoy talking about this stuff a lot.
There's nothing wrong with that, man. Some people are authors who get onto YouTube in order to promote their products. Other people are YouTubers who talk about books or whatever else. And then they're like, hey, I have this platform. I want to tell a story. And so I have this great reach provided by this platform, and I can use that to sell a book. And neither approach is wrong. It's just interesting to see people going at it from two different directions.
Of course. Reminds me that I do have the book for free on Substack. If you go sign up for my email list or not, but please do if you're going to read my book for free or listen to it for free. audiobook. What were we going to say, Pritchard?
Oh, yeah. I think they have the option of like subbing for free and following now on Substack. It used to just be subbing, I think. But I digress. Make sure you go do that. Pick up his book. Check it out. I'm sure it's good. I'm going to go check it out myself. I still got to like go harder on Substack, honestly. But I really love it. That brings me to what I was going to say is using YouTube is not only fun, but it's just like one of the superior video format platforms. Like you combo it with like TikTok and you got long form and short form. So you can like do like podcasts and stuff. Then you can like look at superior audio formats like Spotify, and like I would say Twitter is probably like the short format superior text platform aside from
Facebook doesn't really compare in that regard anymore.
Facebook is dead.
It's really weird. I first got on Facebook in 2007, and so I was there for a long, long time. Never got on MySpace or all that jazz, but. Yeah, mm-hmm. it's very very small demographic people still actively use it.
Yeah. Right.
It was good for memes during political seasons for a while, but not like now it's just nothing. I've been on it for a while. But this does bring
it up is the topic, good for me.
Right. We're going to talk a little bit about the Sweet Baby Ink stuff because how it's like infected video games. I'll maybe skip forward a little bit because talking about why get into social media and besides, I do like talking about this stuff with people like-minded people, but it's a failure in publishers and trying to get published. And maybe it's because my book sucks. Maybe my content sucks, but it really is. It sucks exposure. Because there's. Yeah, well, if you try to do it, if you try to go the traditional way, you really get the feeling that, well, they're looking at people's social media following, so it feels like we kind of like a social credit score, pay to play.
Are you talking about book publishing specifically?
Book publishing specifically. I mean, you could talk about any publishing series, but
you know, that's fair.
Personal experience, just a little bit, just trying to get a literary agent before you can go to a publisher, because the publishers won't even talk to you unless you have an agent representing you. And
an extra gatekeeper. Everything. You literally have a middleman requirement.
There's also the whole issue now that they're doing less for published authors than they've ever done in the past. They're expecting more and giving less value than they've ever have in the past in regards to getting published by one of the big five at this point, because they want to have more control. They want to give you a very small cut. They want you to do a lot of the promotion because they're not going to give the promotion money to a small fish like you. It's going to go to one of their big money making sellers. It's not going to go to you, unfortunately.
They want easy money. And you can't necessarily blame them too much for that, but it's gross when you look, because you have to like go and look up a bunch of different literary agents and then try to like put a like email together to try to cater to who it is. And when you're doing that, you're looking at they all have list of what they're looking for. And 9 out of 10 times you look at it and it's straight white guy, need not apply. Like straight up. They're like looking for people colored.
I've seen it.
It completely public. They're advertising it and it's like gross. Cause then when you start to find, when you do find those people that don't have that in their bios, you're like, well, are they just not putting it there? And then you don't know.
I have personal experience. Because I started following some of these people when I first rejoined Twitter. Because, shocker, AC wasn't always like super like, I'm going to go indie, because I was indie for like over a decade as a musician. And you get sick of that shit. And like kind of
really bad music experiences too.
And also on top of that, the main recognized path in like first and foremost in writing is typically the literary agent and big five route. You shoot for only the biggest things, because the goal is to just have other people do all of that for you and you just sit there and write the whole time because you're a writer. But once you expose yourself to a few of those lists and quickly realize that these agents, that is literally all they're looking for. And they are literally an extension of these big, like corporatized, what's the word? Mafias of, publishers, mm-hmm. essentially. It gets really gross really fast, especially when you look at how they care so much about, like you said, anti-white sex, and then like sexuality, and specifically tying mm-hmm. those things to children.
They're more about checking boxes than actually providing
exactly.
a good story to the readership. Now, I think there is a small issue there. The problem is, for the kind of stories that we want to tell, there are people out there telling those stories, and some of them are even published by these people, but they have been there for a long time. They're already established, and they're all in the mind of the publisher. Those kind of stories are already being produced and funded by them. They're like, we don't want more of those stories. We want to tell the stories for the new generation, and what the new generation says
I'm still reading books from the 60s and the 70s and before that,
30s, it's 20s,
30s, old books. It's like, dude, stop. We like the same stuff. It's like we evolve and we don't evolve in some manners. It's like,
for sure.
Like we're always going to like boobs. Like you're never going to change that.
Boobs, tremendous, boobs. Large tracts of land.
Like there's no way of like socially conditioning people out of that. That's always going to be there.
At least the appreciation, if not a lot more.
But then, and like, so you find an agent and you see that he doesn't have the checkboxes. He works with some people that have the checkboxes on their profile. I'll send it to him. And of course, literary agents, they don't reply back. Like if they don't like it, and they'll tell you, cause you do research and they're always say like, hey guys, it could be the title. I could have read the first word of the title and been like, no, it gets nowhere. Cause apparently they get like hundreds of stuff. I'm like, man, you can't at least just like, hey, I didn't like the title, bye. And I'd be like, okay, at least it's something.
Right. Well, it would be a shame if the title could be changed in a moment. No?
That's the other thing. Yeah. I saw crazy things that were like beyond like checking those boxes and were like doing oxymoronical, like hypocritical, like weird shit, we don't want tropes. It's like a genre is literally a collection of tropes. You realize that, right? Like by definition. So you can already tell that entire like spider web of bullshit that company is associated with already is just like charged with putting everything about redefining things. You know what I mean? You can already tell that they're probably going
to tell stories for a modern audience. No. You need to tell stories, good stories. The audience will come for the stories regardless of what era it is.
Yes.
Stories have not changed in their essential nature for thousands of years.
Yes.
Maybe aspects of their telling have changed. Maybe some of the language, some of the methods, some of the aesthetic has definitely changed. But Hercules turned into Superman, turned into all of these different, like modern day All Might. All Might is a great example of a modern Superman. Tremendous character arc. I love that. Like that,
good
that's
storytelling is like good set of tits.
On All Might. No.
On All Might. Yeah.
Don't look it up, guys. It does exist.
It's probably there.
For sure. I was taking a drink when you said that, dude. What the hell? I almost
said that. You should know I'm going to bring up All Might and tits in the same very often. So just be ready.
And then to bring it back to Sweet Baby Ink, so I bring it up because it's topical, but I mean, you see the same type of gatekeeping in a different way, a little bit more corporate with the video gaming, but it's not working at all with the gamers. It's working with the books, and it's weird because these people have like infested their way into many types of media, and they've left gaming alone for like too long. And
they tried to force themselves in during the first Gamergate, and that's really when it started, because it was free
gamers are too
for a
powerful.
Long time until someone, some guy in the back room started looking at the numbers, how much games were making, more than any movie has ever made. They're like, whoa, 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 whoa. There are a lot of young people, a lot of kids, a lot of men playing these games. There's a huge market here and a huge sphere of influence that we have not taken over yet. Let's get our fingers in that.
So they, I want to say real quick, I can't see the comments, so sorry if I'm not reacting, but
There's something not
StreamYard there. Yeah, but
I got new to it. I got an eye on it over here. I just got to turn my head, but it's all good.
That's a lot of work, though.
Not really.
What are you about to say?
And then they kind of create this idea of, your stories aren't good enough because of the way we've defined what a good story is, instead of acknowledging basic universal truths. This is what I was going to say on your earlier point. There is only one truth. The truth. The truth is the truth. There's not multiple truths, as in we need to redefine everything as whenever we see a little problem with it for the sake of relevance or power, actually, is what I suspect is the biggest thing. And when I say spider web, I really mean spider web, because as you can already tell, you bring up Sweet Baby Inc., you can look at the literary agents, you can look at the Big Five, you can look at gaming, and you can already kind of see this picture forming.
They set root earlier in books and movies and stuff. Like, they, like, even with Gamergate 1, how long ago that was, it's like they didn't have their roots in quite like they did with gaming. And we can see that because the gamers don't give a shit, but like, it's almost an easier playing field for those type of tactics to work, because with books, any one person can write a book and have, you know, a friend make a cover or something like that. The barrier to entry
have always been a little, it's a little easier to escape the restriction of the ideologues that want to control the narrative of the culture. Because there's such an individual aspect to storytelling in the confines of authoring a single book.
And then who can make a game with one person? Like, it's possible technically, but it usually requires teams of people.
I'm looking at you, RimWorld, and looking at you, RimWorld, and what's that other one? It's really good. It's like farming.
Farmville.
Stardew Valley.
Stardew Valley.
Okay, slightly different.
Both like one dude.
What type of game is that? That's not the tabletop RPG, right?
No, it's a video game. They succeeded too. They're probably really wealthy now.
Well, hell, what's that newer game that came out recently? That space
Helldivers
game where you're
Among
that.
Us.
Us. What is it? It's where you go to these planets and there are monsters. You have to collect loot. What the hell is it called?
Not No Man's Sky, but I think I know what you're talking about.
No, it's a different one.
Evolution?
It was basically made by like one kid and a couple of his friends. And it's like one of the biggest games among streamers right now.
Yeah, I mean, it happens sometimes. But frequently, like more than not, it's like it requires a team. So if you're going to get your roots into somewhere and kind of control the narrative, you know, be evil. If, like, if I'm on Team Evil, I'm like, I'd go gaming first, because... like once you have control of that, like, there's, you know, you have maybe one or two people breakthrough, but like with books, I mean isn't Brandon Sanderson technically indie, and he's ruined books?
He's hybrid, so he has all the support of one of the Big Five, but he has the kahunas to persevere through and use indie techniques that he's acquired through his continued role as a teacher at his university that he went through. So he constantly sees new generations of people. He gets to teach them and interact them. Mm-hmm. He sees success stories in indie all across the board, and he is a genius and just like learned from all that. And
it's even more than that, because while still being attached to his publisher, he ran an indie project maybe last year, and it was the most successful Kickstarter book project of all time, with tens of millions of dollars sold for four secret projects, and he didn't even tell people what they were. That's how good he is, man.
And when you got a contract, what kind of pull does that give you then, when you turn around and you stare at your boss, quote unquote, the dude who owns you, and you're like, what now? How much money do you want? Like, cause like, just throw it in his face. You know what I mean? Like, I just destroyed the entire.
That's the trick. They didn't say he couldn't write.
It's a power play.
Outside of, like, they didn't tell him he couldn't write books that could be so they couldn't, they didn't tell him he couldn't self-publish a book. He just had to fulfill his contractual obligation for the number of books. But the problem is the man's a machine.
He writes
faster than almost anyone I know.
And yeah, plus with he team, writes.
It's no brainer, man.
Because what was it like in a 3 year period? It was something like 3 or 4 years. He wrote like 7 books, and they're not including like short a
Stormlight
books.
Book. Each Stormlight book is longer than the entirety of Lord of the Rings.
This one's gonna be like 500,000 words, like legit.
Yeah, he's gonna set some record like that for sure.
He's already approaching like the most written words of any individual
author. Real quick, before we drift away from Sanderson and back into other things, which I would be curious about what Sanderson really thinks about the interference of culture is what I'll call it, or the interjection of religious ideology into common truth. But we'll step away from that just for a second, and I can read off some of the chat here. Kahuna, if you have it pulled up
or like whatever.
Yeah, because next we're gonna do a little bit of the toxicity stuff.
Oh yeah, that'll be fun. Yeah. So hail to Immortal Rising Comics and Readout Productions, Evelay Music, Daniel P. Riley. Hail, you guys are awesome. BA Turner.
Why is Battsauce reading Fourth Wing? The short bus veteran. Oh, it's all coming together.
You call me retarded.
Rexillian, hail.
Yo. Mr. B.A. Turner. I still need to read his book. I started it. It's really good.
As soon as I'm done with the Black Crown, I'm gonna get it.
Yeah.
I'm sure, you'll have to tell me what you think of the end of the Black Crown, because I really like the book. I do have some thoughts on the end though, and I have talked to John about that. But I'm curious what you think about the end of that book when it comes around.
It definitely, we could talk about it.
I'll do the same. We'll have like a Black Crown.
Yeah.
The blackest of crowns. We call it an African American.
The biggest crowns. We have the biggest
crowns. The black crowns are larger than the other crowns.
All right, any more to read off? Or?
That was it. Well, we could go through individual comments, but we've been going for a little bit, so it would be doing that for a while. Yeah. You guys are all awesome. Thanks for joining us.
Yes,
yeah, I really appreciate it, guys.
And for all of you not subscribe. Here, how dare you? No, I'm good.
All right, so I'm sure we're not the first people you've heard this from. Probably seen it on Twitter or somewhere. Likewise, so we have a company trying to start a toxicity rating for games, which just seems like a goal. But
yeah, are you a straight white male? Your opinion doesn't matter.
Clip so that. And they're also a consulting company too.
Of course they are. Here's the level of quality service we can provide for you.
Which is right. Like, dude, this is obviously a big, huge grift. They're obviously, they know their victim points is currency, right? So they're just putting this out there. They're probably going to use the hate because it's getting so much hate on Twitter. So they're probably going to use that and be like, hey, look, Twitter hates this. Elon bad.
Basement dwelling milk drinkers, mouth breathing like, weirdos.
Look at all the bad pale people on this platform and how toxic they are.
These are the exact people you don't want. And it's they're going to get a big paycheck from the companies because they're going to get hired. I mean, I can't get into it, but you can see it. It's more like in many realms, they're hiring these consulting companies because they're just dumb businessmen. They're just like, what am I supposed to do? What are the directions say?
Look at Anita Sarkeesian. She has been hired every year consistently since she basically stopped doing her feminist frequency BS. Like she stopped posting that a long time ago, and she is doing just fine financially.
It's an extra layer on top of the. It's an extra layer on top of like the literary agent type shit. Just she another babysitter.
Here's the real question though: is she earning enough to get plastic surgery that can actually make her an attractive woman again, or is she not quite at that threshold yet? I'm just curious.
I think most people would accept relatively human looking, at least. That would be.
Truth be told, I hate most plastic surgery. I think it most makes most people.
I'm right there with you, man.
True.
I'm right there with you.
It's off. Yeah, I mean, that's uncanny valley. Uncanny valley shit.
Andy, never let your wife do it. Never.
Oh, she doesn't care for that. She's pretty natural. Like one of the things that first attracted me to her was her lack of makeup, and still just immense amount of beauty. And
if you find a woman who's beautiful without going through the whole thing. That's a wonderful thing. And Battsauce, you're married, right, too?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, tremendous, man. Tremendous. I guess I'll be the
she hears me talking about her. I gotta stop. I gotta stop, guys, but I'll whisper.
No, honey, no.
So yeah, we got Call of Duty with a 78% toxicity.
78.
I'm quite disappointed in Call of Duty, honestly.
Yikes. It could have at least pulled 90. Really, it could have at least pulled 90.
Also, wait, we need to see what is contributing as well.
Violence. That's almost a splatty tomato.
What's his game? That's a splatty. It's mostly
violence in a game based about killing people with guns. Weird.
Yeah. Weird. Yeah. And a lot of it takes place in like with imperialistic Western countries, like in a setting of like third world countries.
It'd be a shame if Russia was the bad guy in every Call of Duty game.
Serious lack of gender discrimination here.
I know. I want to be fighting some Muslims.
Serious lack. No,
yeah. Also, Eric and Evelyn are saying the 78%. That's rookie numbers.
I agree, man. Gotta bump those numbers up. Let's go.
Crank it up.
I'd love to see how, like, what the how they're measuring this. I'd love to know.
Yeah.
I'd love to know.
We'll get into that. I believe that we know, and that's why it's kind of funny that
honest people really like us into that. Can come in and share our discrimination experiences on these games.
Oh, wait, guys, we need to be, like, evil, right? So let me, there we go.
Oh, let's well, so for the toxicity, wait one second.
Galaxy.
There we go. Join me. Join me.
And together we can rule the galaxy as father and son. Isn't that Vader's line? Shut up.
Minecraft, a lot of violence.
In Minecraft, what?
Like butchering sheep?
Sexual like content, less gender blocks. Discrimination.
Yeah.
Racism.
I guess a lot of threats. Probably a lot of people say I'm going to rape your mom, but
in Minecraft.
So I'm getting a lot of kids are still playing Minecraft. Good.
Oh yeah, yeah. 76 on Apex with that weak. That diversity. Come on, man.
I know.
It's also all like this the same numbers, right? So it's kind of interesting. Why are they all so close to 70%? It's like, are these
also bad surveys? I'm noticing less racism than I was expecting. Truth be told. I'm disappointed.
Yeah, yeah.
Yo, you ever play this game, Mordhau?
Mordhau?
I can't say I have. Yeah.
So it's a medieval simulator, if you know what that is. It's a bit you play a knight and you medieval. Yeah.
Yeah.
Play some knights, you know?
Sick.
Yeah, that game awesome was like famous. I think there was even an article when it like came out because there was no censorship on the chat, so it's just like N-word,
yeah.
C-word, and just
the funny thing is I don't know if they realize that like people just say everything, like they say everything, especially as soon as they realize they have freedom, they're just gonna be like, fuck, you know what I mean?
Here in America specifically, yes. In a place like Japan, like tell them they have freedom, they're like,
silence. Finally,
screw
peace.
Your mom. I guess I don't know.
Yes, finally peace.
So yeah, they would you had a guy like cosplaying Kanye West essentially in the chat, just like acting like he's Kanye West.
Well, dude,
it was great.
That's hilarious. But I'm sorry.
I say
the dude's rich. I don't give a fuck.
Emily says people said necromancer and cancer. Man, that's upsetting.
I'm assuming this is probably what's on the screen now. This honestly is probably the only way that they're actually getting their numbers from their own survey. Like I said, this is like they're doing bare minimal work. They're like, they put up a little survey, had somebody create it for
half
fucking
the people
$10
have to just
probably
be playing around, right? Just like we're doing right now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So they just have this is just a site for them to show the businessmen to be like, oh my God, it's interactive and whatnot.
But it's not actually a study. It has no regulation or anything. It's all on X, as you said, right? It's all like just on X. Like, what is that? Like any scientist would be like, well, you need some sort of control or something.
No. How about just random people off with an anonymous survey on the internet? Yeah. Surely that can't be fabricated.
And when it comes from
it's this thing about quantifying. When you're a big like organizations. They're obsessed with quantifying. And in my new book, there's a whole chapter on quantifying. It's something I fucking hate that word.
If
right?
you say quantifying one more time, I'm going to go cross-eyed for the rest of the
hunting fight. So yeah, essentially they're obsessed with just seeing numbers and whatever they mean. Like, they don't actually like care about what that number means, because working in IT, you always want to hear like, we need a lot of tickets done. We're like, okay, so if we get a big number of tickets, you'll be happy. And they're like, essentially, yeah, that's going to make us look good. I'm like, okay, cool. I can create 10 accounts in 10 minutes, and that's 10 tickets. That requires no work. Or I can try to fix somebody's computer that blew up and like recover data or something like that. And that takes like maybe a couple days or whatever, depending on it. 100%. And you're like, that's one ticket. Well, by quantifying it, I'm doing worse. And but it doesn't matter. They don't look at things like that. Like, they're just like, and you have like some IT places where it's just literally they just make as many tickets as they can. And the people that are doing best are usually just making like 10 tickets out of like one issue. And it's quantifying. So,
yeah. They're like, I remember when I was younger and I finally discovered, oh, maybe the internet is full of shit. It took me longer than most, because I wasn't on the internet when I was really, really young. But yeah. I was at some point, I'm like, oh, everybody's lying. I have to wade through this slightly differently than the blind dive that I was doing.
Evelyn wants to know my profile picture. Stop sharing real quick. So this is Royce trying to seduce people to the dark side, as he usually is doing all the time.
Sick. Colorful side, for sure.
I saw him doing the same thing for the furry conventions he frequents at.
Yes, obviously. and it works out, because it's already the size of some animals, being only 5'4", you know.
Yeah. The Scientology one was great.
Yeah, I mean, I met him in person. He's fine.
He said, do you guys want superpowers? Well, if you pay enough, you can skip the line. Just come with me.
Just come with me.
Guys, it's only 90s gay. Shut up.
All right, let's take this damn survey. So what game?
90s gay is different.
What game are we going to rate? We're going to rate their toxicity level. All right. So what you see on the screen, that's our only choices right now. What do you guys want to rate?
Okay. So Oh, man. I kind of want to do one with the chat in some way, too, if possible. Are we able to do a poll in the chat?
Ooh, I don't know how to do that.
I don't know. We don't even have access to the comments from here. So
how about this?
Going on.
First one to, we'll count the first vote that pops up or whatever. We'll look at like the general amount in the chat. Me and Kahuna will monitor the chat. But you guys can vote.
Veto toxic?
Am I veto toxic?
I don't know what that means.
Like veto. I'm assuming veto Giswaldi. No. What does that mean?
Yeah, I'm not sure.
It's not veto as in VE. It's VITO. I'm not sure.
Yeah. The freaking forgot his name or his show, but he's a fat guy making a super killer comic. Anyway.
What do you guys think? We do Call of Duty, Fortnite, Minecraft, Apex Legends,
what game,
Valorant,
guys?
Animal Crossing, New Horizons, Rocket League, Destiny 2, Halo Infinite, or GTA Online.
Let's see. My vote is, I mean,
Animal Crossing. I want I want to say they're the most racist, discriminatory.
So, okay.
Yes, they were sexuality. Sexual. Of course.
They were.
Very sexual.
Very, very sexual.
Extremely sexual. I felt violated just watching it.
All right. I felt gay just controlled substances. Is there drug dealing in Animal Crossing? I've never played it.
You can exchange things,
hear me out. You can eat food, and food releases dopamine in your brain, which is a drug. So therefore, you have a euphoric effect. From
that sounds very extreme, radical.
Very.
Let's be a little bit realistic on this, right? Let's say, you know, when you fill out those surveys,
I mean,
that they make you do, and you're just like, all right, let me change one or two.
It was extremely sexual.
Yeah, sorry, I hit the previous one.
Crude humor. No, it was all very, very, very based humor.
brake pants.
There's no base option though. Yeah, so we're unsure.
How unsure am I about the
I'm extremely unsure. I'm extremely unsure about it.
Racism, yes. Tremendous. Yes,
of course.
Dude, they're all different races, the animals. Are you kidding me?
Wait. Yeah. Is it
all? Why wouldn't they all just be the same race and gender?
Oh, I specifically. Oh, well, sorry, what was that? anytime you have any like character you could design, you make them a little bit darker skin, you have them farming, absolutely automatically racist.
I would say gamer names. Let's come up with some good racist gamer names.
Where do we expand this? I'm going to say we experience it.
Oh, all of them. Yeah, yeah.
Gamer names? What?
Dr. Boobalicious was very aggressive.
Doctor, it's not really racist, though.
It can be.
Tell me how that is.
Dr. Boobalish.
Licious, how do you?
Perfect. It's perfect. Dark Dong 69 was also very, very discriminatory. Oh my god, bro. What is this?
What is it? They told me I can't do anything but farm. Because they're, I'm Mexican.
They told me to get to work, cracker. There we go. AC, I can't hear you, brother.
That's all right. I'm just.
Do we hear any other bad things?
There we go. Sweet. Perfect. Yeah.
Dr. Boobalish, Dark Dog. Dark Dog. Violence indicates. Please indicate if interactive user generated aspects of this game included descriptions of inferences.
I would say I'd be unsure of the violence in Animal Crossing.
Can you describe how unsure you are?
Did you experience violence, extreme violence and racism together? Yes, 100%.
As stated before, they're all different races of animals.
The black bears were really discriminatory against
and the and bears. Against the white dogs.
Oh. Yo, those chocolate labs, he run in this hood.
What other animals are there on there? I forgot, man. There's like the
dog. I've never played it. I have no idea.
Who's the mayor? What animal is he? Oh yeah, he's like a raccoon. Mention raccoons. No, something
BS
about raccoons.
A raccoon runs the animal kingdom. Bullshit.
Wait.
I wasn't even reading what you did. They went to me to the farm. They threw my white dog in the river and called me a Mexican.
Damn, dude.
Because I kept stabbing. All of that's amazing. YouTube, if you're watching this, this is all in Minecraft, by the way. This is
fine. Yes.
This is
for well, no, it's Animal Crossing.
Yeah,
this
yeah.
How do you spell purposes. Puerto Rican?
Spell it wrong on purpose. It won't matter.
Actually.
I yeah, Puerto right. Ricane.
Oh my god. Spell it wrong on purpose.
Ricane. Puerto Ricane. My favorite. Gender discrimination. All right.
Gender discrimination indicates. We definitely had gender discrimination.
Oh, for sure.
Where did you experience gender?
Probably in the chat. All of it. For sure.
Oh, all yeah. of it.
All of it.
Yeah, I observed yes, it too. It was yes. horrible. I have nightmares. Oh, yeah, sorry.
Yes, for sure.
I have nightmares. Did you observe? Together all the time. When is it not used together?
What
is it? It's a better question.
I'm glad that we're contributing something to the community.
You know, I often question that, like day to day. Is like, am I contributing to society enough? And I feel like now I could really contribute to society. Guys, look up the toxicity survey. And please take part, do your job, and
do your
help
part.
Society.
Report the terrible
we're doing
people
our part.
We're doing our part. Communities. I would love to see like a bunch of people start playing Animal Crossing now.
Would you like to know more?
That's my secret, Cap. It's always been racist.
It's always been racist. It's always been racist. Always has been.
Oh yeah, the astronaut.
Yeah.
Oh,
there's the blending of two memes right there.
I do love people when they're like, "They're America's the most racist country in history." Like,
whatever.
One of the first cultures in human history to outlaw slavery. You're right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
one
you're
of
right.
Most racist countries in history.
Yeah.
So I tried to drive a car, but I kept crashing. I'm a woman. It should prevent me from crashing. Please make that an option in the game.
Or is it? Or I'm talking. Oh, too loud. I was gonna say. Or
I signed off on this.
Or is it because I'm Chinese? I don't know.
I condone this. This is great. This is great.
All right. Great. Oof. What is your okay? What's our gender?
I know.
Why wasn't that asked first?
Other. Toucan other. Sexual. Other sexual.
Toucan sexual. Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
I sexually identify as.
No. One word. One word. You gotta do a proper representation. All one word. Toucan sexual. There you go.
Here we go. I got another one. Because I should be able to add multiple genders. That's only fair.
You're right. I'm actually that multiple absolutely genders. Absolutely.
100%. Fourth way sexual.
Dude, you're breaking me right
clip,
now.
Bro, I have to clip this later for that video.
I'm a fifth level fourth wing sexual.
Fifth level, yeah. Fourth wing. Oh my lord!
All right.
Also, prefer not to say. It has to be prefer not to say.
Well, I can't. I mean, I can choose my age. So
I identify as someone much older than I am.
Where are we from?
I feel old. What's the Germany least controversial country in history?
Well, I said I'm Puerto Rican. I'm Puerto Rican from Germany.
Of course, that's where all the Puerto Ricans come from, right?
All right. Oh,
vegan or Herman offered vegan sexual.
Vegan sexual.
I would agree, except it's impossible to be a sexual vegan. There's nothing sexy about saying meat is.
I got
on
you.
The menu.
I got you. I got you, Herman.
Oh, I guess if we can do everything, why not? You look old. F you, Herman. Look old. Is it the red light or the bags under my eyes, you sack of shit?
It's a vegan antisexual.
Dude, the antisexual.
Oh, bro. It's killing me. Oh. And fourth wing sexual. We'll be added to some wiki somewhere.
You know, the thing is, like, they're not reading this. Like, they're not working. This is 100% a grift. They're going to just add it to the stats because they're just going to take it as another person who took the survey. Yeah, so am I helping out their terrible grift? Yes, but funny. I mean, they're going to get their grift either way.
For sure.
Probably having bots do this as well.
Hey, cheers, Evelyn. Evelyn. Keep on calling them the wrong name.
Do you guys want us to rate more games? Or do you guys want us to move on? Because we can move on.
Move on. Yeah. We could always come back later if we want.
Dude, still let us know in the chat what you think of like a little mini game every now and then.
Yeah. Hey guys, we're trying to figure out the show. You know, this isn't we're all very very
we've
small
gone
YouTubers
off the
trying to figure our way
of the in the iron in the iron seas. We've gone into the foggy land of indie.
The iron seas is vast.
As you can see,
so right. Vast.
Yeah,
both sides.
So yeah, no. Maybe not today, but somewhere down the line, it'd be fun to get permission and read like a single Substack story, like short story of somebody's on.
Yeah, I definitely want to do that. Yeah. Definitely want to do that.
I'm down,
guys. If you're listening, we're down to start doing guests as well. Just keep in mind, this show, if we do have a guest, it's not going to be like 100% contributed to the guest, but we'll like leave. Like 10, 20 minutes or 30 minutes or so.
Probably about 20 minutes. Any longer
20 minutes, I think,
uncomfortable usually.
Yeah. So we'll leave a little segment for you guys to talk about yourself, advertise your stuff. But the show is going to be, we're having fun and we're talking about some relevant media type stuff and sometimes just generic indie stuff that a little bit more timeless, right?
I have a question. I have a question for you, too. Is there an old franchise that has been worked on recently that has not been ruined by the recent efforts? I might think I can think of maybe one, and that's even questionable itself.
Well, it was Avatar ruined by the live action. I don't think so.
Well, like I can because, like, I still love, despite the new movies, I still love Star Wars. I love the old movies. Like that love will never change.
But it killed the universe. It killed the universe, though. It did. So that's the problem. Whereas in the Avatar universe,
I don't think it's had enough time.
Korra was pretty bad. Korra, I mean, it wasn't the worst, but
better than the OG series. Some things.
Well, the action
were a lot better. The action was very.
I disagree with that. I disagree with the villains being better. Do we get into this now?
Oh. Are we going to fight about Korra? No way! Get Royce in here!
We could have the great Avatar debate.
I am he who knows 10,000 things about Avatar and Korra.
All right, Royce, get the fuck in here, Royce. We're fighting.
Right? There you go.
What do you think, Royce? Lord of the Rings. I need a tremendous 5'4" Royce energy.
I can't hear you. I'm only 5'4".
My wife can beat me up. She liked all the Catholic boys.
You heard him. He's only 5'4", so...
Remember, guys, Royce is only 5'4". Everybody, you must post Royce's 5'4". That's the secret.
And the Gilded, just mash it down there. It's not a conspiracy. It's fact. Man, I had technical issues. I can't do my voice mod thing.
Joe, I adore Avatar, the first show. I love it.
Yeah.
It is, and I far prefer it. Not even close.
Some would say it's a perfect show.
And I wouldn't argue with them. I'd say FMA Brotherhood is also a perfect show.
I was going to say
that is my favorite anime of all time, despite it being. Yeah, you and I talked about this. Yeah, I love that.
Yeah.
We don't need to fight about that. We can fight about whether the villains from Legend of Korra at least stack up or are better than some of the original villains from Avatar. I think
you could argue stack up, but. Better.
I think Zaheer is one of the best villains in any kids TV show ever.
The airbending one?
Yes.
Okay. I remember the names.
Of season 3 Legend of Korra with the leader of the Red Lotus. Yes. Him.
Yeah, but like I think everything they did was just too world breaking, and I don't like the way he twisted the airbender logic was kind of a little retarded.
Quick question. Let me interject quick.
Go ahead.
Jay. Sure.
So, can you acknowledge a well-written villain in a world-breaking vandalistic recreation like Korra? Because it's kind of like, well, it's a continuation, I should say. Continuation. You said you have problems with the world-breaking stuff. There are
problems with Korra. I don't think Zaheer and the Red Lotus were among them. I think they were. I thought that was it's the only.
Let's talk about lava bending real quick, though.
Lava bending.
We can talk about it. Lava bending is one of the things
I like and I don't like. And I mostly don't like it because it was just it was just absolutely broken.
Interesting.
Well, it's so rare. It's even rarer than metal bending. But it also it functions very differently.
It's supposed to be.
Why?
Metal building is about taking the firm stance and becoming even more pointed than regular earth bending.
They ruined metal bending in Korra.
Oh,
there was rules in the OG, and that was like you had to use the what's her name, the blind one, brain farting.
Tough.
Because she used the sensory stuff, she was able to pick up the metal and be able to bend it. So assumption and more than just an assumption that you had to use that ability, which Aang also learned from Toph in order to do the metal bending. So if you can't touch the earth, you can't metal bend. And yet in Korra,
she was able to unlock the, like, basically it's like everything seems impossible until someone does it. And then a lot more people, like, think about flying. Yeah. Think about flying.
Like the Wright brothers, man. Everyone said rules.
It could not be done. They started it, and then eventually it became easier.
Wait, think about what? Movie. Think about what? What'd you say?
Oh, flying. The Wright brothers. Flying. Until they did it, everyone said, this cannot be done. This is a myth. This is impossible. They did it. Now it doesn't get great for a while, but eventually it becomes more accessible, more possible because people have a blueprint, the standing on the shoulders of giants kind of
thing. Well, that's fine. Did they have an explanation for it though? They didn't. They kind of glanced over that. They're just like, just accept it.
Well, they kind of did because they said that it could not everybody could do it. Still, at this point, even now, not everybody can metal bend. So there, it's like not every firebender can lightning bend either.
But, okay, so two things.
Exactly, it's supposed to be a rarity. Yeah, like extreme rarity. Yeah,
the airbending flying was cool, right? Like I can accept that change.
Yes.
But when it comes to the metal bending specifically, it like almost became inherited. Like you can inherit, like you're inherited the ability to metal bend. When that's not the case. Toph, through extreme training, learned how to metal bend. And then you take the same logic to the lightning bending. Why the fuck can everybody let lightning bend? You like Zuko didn't learn how to lightning bend in the OG.
Right, right, right. It was I
have an explanation for
that.
Yeah, yeah. He tried to learn.
I don't know if he could when he was older. They never really go into that. But because maybe he was more balanced in his spirit when he was old, but maybe he never learned.
Maybe part
of it was that the lightning bending was kept to the upper crust military and royal families within the fire. So, they didn't teach everybody how to do it. And so I don't think everybody could, but
that checks out with Iroh and
it checks out because you had to either be balanced like Iroh or you had to be crazy like Sula. Now the main character can't remember his name because nobody gives a shit about the Korra people. who was the lightning bender, fire bender, and Mako? Okay.
See, I think
how could he lightning bend?
Like I said, by then it wasn't the teaching of that technique was not restricted.
The upper class. Did he show any ability, like any reasoning of being balanced or being crazy?
Because remember in season one, they described him when he was pro bending as cool under fire kind of attitude. He was able to think clearly even in a dire, stressful situation and keep his cool.
What about the gang member in the first episode? Everybody who could fire bend could also lightning bend. Like it wasn't rare.
The gang member couldn't. The gang leader could. That's what I.
He wasn't like a gang leader though, was he?
The guy who had his bending taken away by Amon season one, he could lightning bend, but he was the leader of that gang. And you would think, upper crust leader, guy has to be in charge of a whole bunch of people, has to be controlled enough to be able to manage a large group of freaking criminals. He could do that.
You're writing for the story.
I am.
Gotcha.
I have a lot of problems with Korra, but I still do think it has both strong points.
Well, I think that's what happens is you go in with a lot of like good faith, and like this happened with Star Wars. People went in with the good, like people looked when they first saw Force Awakens. Everybody's like, "Yo, this movie's bangs. This is good. Star Wars is like good." But then you look back and you're like, "Dude, Force Awakens was just as bad as the other three, as bad." Like maybe even worse. This,
if the next two movies had been good, we would look back at Force Awakens much more fondly than we do.
Well, 100%. But like when you look at it with a critical, unbiased eye, because like without that good faith that Star Wars has lost, because it lost some people. But like Last Jedi was just so bad that made everybody lose their good faith for anything coming forward.
Some people Avatar. Who agree with me now still had faith after The Last Jedi. I'm like, how
I did.
no way.
I did because I think any writer should be able to I'm telling you, I could have read a story and you've been like, holy shit, that's actually like good. Because look.
Oh, for Star
Wars.
You
still have the Star Wars universe, right? So you could by yourself, you could write any movie that's good and be good and standalone. You could take shit characters and make them good in one story. And people who say otherwise, I just like those talented writers. If you put Brandon Sanderson in to write the last movie, it would have been good. And
probably
when you pay the amount of money that you
a lot to bring me back though after
but it's
something like Sanderson.
You can't undo all the damage.
I'm not saying it wouldn't be a challenge. It would be like an impossible challenge. but it's there. I mean, first, like, Kylo Ren wasn't, like, completely ruined. They could have made him, they could have worked and spent the first 15 minutes.
Completely ruined. They even had some good ideas. And, let me one thing I can praise about The Last Jedi, the movie that I despise with every fiber of my being.
Yeah.
It was a very pretty looking film.
Yeah.
Color choices, the light choices.
You can see the money. A lot
of that was really, like, their almonds were activated for some stuff. Hold on, I have to read this comment by Evelie because it's throwing me off. I teach kids guitar from time to time. It warms my heart and warms my balls and tickles my heart when kids want to learn Aces High, which happens about once a year.
Hell yeah. Hell yeah.
Also, you all hear the rebooting Big Trouble in Little China?
Oh.
JK, day late, April Fools. He says.
So, Kylo Ren, yeah, he did suck because he was written stuff, but he was also played by an awesome actor.
Adam Driver's the shit.
Adam Driver's fucking, he's such a good actor.
You know, he's
just fine. Watch anything else he's in.
he's fine. I've seen others. He's fine.
Marriage Story? You see Marriage Story?
Yeah, yeah.
I heard that was Craig.
He's fine. I don't have any... Yeah. Anything, I don't dislike him, but I don't have any affinity for him either.
I got a little bit more favoritism because he was a Marine too.
Oh, yeah.
That's cool. That. He's a veteran?
Yeah.
So I'm smoking a crayon in a movie once. I was like, that's my boy!
That's my boy. But no, I mean, back to Katara. Or Korra. Fucking shit.
Yes, Korra.
He doesn't even know who's in what show. He's fake news.
Before we get back to Korra, yeah, my only experiences with The Last Airbender, one with Aang, you know, those three books. And all I know is that the storytelling is so good and, well, good in the sense, like, a lot of stories are subjective. You know, you could have, like, a one-sentence story that's just a banger. But, like, I digress. It's so, I guess, universally accepted that there's a lot of people that literally teach...
It's
a lot of the storytelling devices that they're doing in there. Here's an example of a good redemption arc. Here's a good villain. You know, here's a good mentor, Iroh. You know what I mean? Just look at every aspect, and they're all clear-cut great examples. And we didn't realize in the time when Avatar was coming out what kind of a anomaly it was going to be. And I think all they did was kind of check the boxes back then, which was write a good story, which happened to be universal truths like the hero's journey and stuff like that. And circling that idea back to the agents, I have seen people talking about how they specifically say no hero's journey and stuff like that. They're literally throwing away things that we've learned and come to know to be true, universal truths over
it's guidelines.
Centuries. Yeah, yeah.
She was trying to query a particular set of stories to some agents a couple years ago, and they were telling her, we want some villain stories. That's what.
Let's talk about the gray villain shit, right? Like, every villain needs to be gray, and it's like they found out
every villain no one can just be a dick. No one.
Right, and look, I like a good gray villain, right? Morally gray.
Grandma.
It's like they saw a few stories do it right back in the day, and it's like Hollywood always takes the wrong lesson. And they're like, oh, gray, morally gray villain equals better. And now they're pushing it even farther, because now it's not even just they're morally gray, it's that the system made them the way they are, and they actually are not bad people.
It always morphs into a rebellion arc.
No, well, that brings up an essential difference in our way, I think all of our philosophies and theirs, which is that, like, they see someone who is in a, like, this evil adult who does these bad things, and they're like, well, they were ruined by what happened when they were grown. I'm like, at some point, it's up to you to become the better person. It's at some point you can no longer blame what happened when you were young.
It's a victim mentality.
Accountability. You gotta clean your room. You gotta look inward, and you gotta recognize the strengths in the roles of your masculinity.
Talk to the shadow and really,
you gotta take accountability for your actions.
This is not
villains are victims.
Only when we take accountability for our actions.
All right, so
it's accountability, though, for sure.
Yeah. No, look, the conspiracy theories that they're trying to push, the fact that there's, what'd you just say? I brain fart super hard sometimes.
Jordan Peterson.
Yeah, what'd you just say?
Accountability.
Yeah. They're trying to like take away people's agency in accountability. And that's what they're trying to like get people to think or understand. Well, I don't know.
Well, here's the thing. Think about this. Injustice. Okay. Right. If you feel like you can do something violent for the sake of an idea like injustice, and let's just for this hypothetical situation say that you happen to be misguided. This is an untruth that you feel. This is not an injustice, but you feel like it is.
Oh, he's talking about the concept of injustice. I thought you were talking about the comic storyline of injustice.
No. The concept. I lost my train of thought.
Sorry.
Injustice. That's so good.
Injustice.
What were we talking about before that? Sorry.
Penis.
Yeah, penis.
Well, sometimes you mention something else and then it'll come back up.
Accountability? Yeah. Okay, accountability. Yeah, yeah. Injustice. Let's say you decide to do something violent about this injustice that you're misguided about. You can then not take accountability for it and just blame the injustice. Like, it's the injustice that did it. I had to do it. I had to, like, throw the paint on the cultural iconic painting, or I had to behead the statue like Bart Simpson out of The Simpsons or some shit. You know what I mean? Stuff like that. And then you don't have accountability.
And it's like an inability to storytell, right? And where it's like you can use some of those aspects where it's like, yeah, we understand how he became a villain. But there has to be the acknowledgement that morally he is wrong and he is the villain. And that's where they're changing and they're losing people. Cause it's like, okay, we have the thing that made him the villain and it might not make you a villain. And that's the difference between you and that villain, but they're acting like they're not morally wrong for becoming a villain because of the injustice that happened to him. And that's where it becomes bad.
They do one of two things, either because of what happened in their past and because of their oppressed nature, their victimhood, they are not responsible for how they are. And in fact, they aren't even evil because of what happened to them, or they're an irredeemable monster. In the modern day, it depends on the ethnicity and the gender of who the antagonist is, but there are ways to do it. Yeah. Let's go back to one of our favorite stories, FMA Brotherhood. Look at Scar. He was a great example of someone doing bad things for a justifiable reason.
Really bad things.
He undergoes transformation. He takes the old and the new and truly creates something new. And it's a beautiful story arc. And that's just one character. There are other characters that show.
Redeemed villain,
the exact same thing. Like, Roy Mustang. He was basically like a member of the non-German army and used his flame alchemy that he stole and used against his master's wishes for evil.
Bro. And also, let's be real, Uncle Iroh already redeemed.
Oh yeah,
freaking conquest lord.
He's
a freaking con. He was a con, a fire lord con, basically. You know, like.
But we also don't know that he's redeemed in the beginning, Iroh? Kind of.
Yeah, Iroh? Well, right. Yeah. Right.
The fruit of his choices in his life and his temperament are so different. We know.
Yeah.
I don't know if whether he's redeemed or not. That's a philosophical question. Whether he has become a different person, that's not in question. He has transformed.
100%. So now let's change the topic. Unless you have something else you're gonna say.
Evelyn Music Kahuna with his crab claw right now. Are you talking about my surfboard?
Yeah, it's a crab claw.
Crab.
Also, Evelyn has not seen FMA Brotherhood. Roy Mustang, is that a real guy? Oh.
Look,
you have to watch it, Evelyn.
It is. You got to watch it.
He might be trolling, right? But no, I mean, like, FMA is like one of those things where like it gets suggested to a lot of people and they just hear it suggested over and over again and they almost are like, I feel like it's going to be disappointing. It 100% can. Now that we're on the topic, I want to bring up this symbolism. I already told you, AC, but like symbolism? One of the most obvious in FMA, like there's so much, right? One of the most obvious things that like a lot of people miss. Do you know what Edward, Alphonse, and their dad? Do you know what they represent? Don't answer, AC.
Father, Son, Holy Spirit.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, I never had that point.
The mangaka, the woman who wrote that, she was a genius. Also, how does a woman understand how to write brothers as well as she does?
Because she's human.
I don't understand it, dude. It's insane.
So, but like that was like something I came to a conclusion a couple of years ago, but like I read it like 10 years prior, or you know, watched it, and I was like, it was so obvious. But it's those little slight things I love. Dude, so she has another manga that's currently out. I've been reading. It has a lot of chapters.
Yeah, new one, right?
No,
yeah,
it's already out.
I need to read it.
Terrible name. Terrible name.
Oh no.
And it's also not as good as
Japanese sometimes do that.
Well, it's not that. But it's just super generic. It's Demons of the Underworld. I want to say
that's like generic
or Shadows or the Shadow World. Yeah.
AC, so can't hear you, brother.
Yeah, I mean, you can just search her and you'll find it. It's good though. It's good. It's entertaining. But it's not just the level of FMA. Hell yeah, man.
Yeah, hell yeah. Yeah. Oh, bro. Like the
better book right here though. Just oh shit.
you know the problem with this show and this mangaka or manga, mm-hmm. We could do an entire show just on that.
100%, and that's why I'm gonna say we'll change the subject to what we're supposed to talk about.
Also, real we'll close quick, Evely offered up his own guesses about what they represented in the story: wind, water, rock, tobacco, metal. Rock, metal, and pilsners.
I like his guesses.
That's good guesses. Yeah, yeah. No, because I always like to say, because sometimes people are like, "Oh, I never thought about that." I'm like, "No, right? It's so simple." But yeah, let's talk about conservative media. Let's talk about Daily Wire, right? Reason I want to talk about we're gonna talk about Candace Owens, and no, I'm just kidding, we're not talking about that whole spiel.
I've kind of stayed away from her news, so but we can talk
about I don't really care about it. It's whatever the conservatives are fighting, but I'm really just talking about their attempt to impact the culture, and that's what I mean to talk about.
And with their movies,
yeah, because this is a storytelling podcast, so all storytelling,
since we're all authors,
right? And from what I know is they made this big push to go into culture with these movies and trying to compete with other streaming services, which they don't have the money to try to keep up with. Like, first of all, their backlog. Much,
they don't have enough of a backlog.
They're making
the same mistakes. Like,
yeah, well, yeah. I mean, that's a whole nother point. But like, they don't have a backlog. Their backlog is their YouTube, which nobody gives shit about. Like,
if you like somebody in the Daily Wire, you're probably watching them individually. Like, I like Jordan Peterson. I watch his own stuff. I don't have to go to the Daily Wire for that. Sorry.
That debate with Destiny was lit.
Yeah, that was good.
That was a great debate. Destiny's a weird guy, a little bit.
You can learn a lot watching that. You can learn a lot.
I watch Destiny sometimes. I disagree with them a lot politically, but
proximity to other streamers that I do.
Here's my takeaway on Destiny: the big D. Okay. I give you all the respect in the world, brother. If you ever are listening to this, I give you all the benefit of the doubt and the respect in the world for being the only person on that side. And this is a centrist point of view. The only person on that side willing to go into enemy territory, so to speak, and say some stuff and try. You're giving it a shot, and he does a good job in the world for that. Yeah.
No one can say that he was just a nothing burger who didn't think things through. He did think things through. I just don't agree with all of
his conclusions.
He's a smart person, and he's really good at debating. And I don't know if he's on crack or just
he's trying to win points though instead of discuss the truth.
He is, but you see him argue a lot of conservatives and prominent conservatives that do a lot of debates. And
hail the call of reckoning. Thanks for sticking sometimes. Around for a while, brother. See you tomorrow.
Yo. Yeah, I just reviewed his comic very recently. It's pretty baller. Yeah, third one comes out in like 5 days or so. So definitely pick that up. It was good.
Shout out.
It's good. Especially UAC, man. It's like a government conspiracy type-ish.
Know about a lot of that due to proximity to my mother, because her problem is she believes all conspiracy, every single one.
That is a problem.
Some of these can be true. All of these cannot be true.
Yeah.
At once.
Well, the government's extremely incompetent, which is the biggest hole in a lot of conspiracies. I find. Yeah.
So like you can't with even get people to agree, like five people who work in different businesses to agree in a room.
Yeah.
You think there's these thousands of people pulling the strings, all coordinated, not fighting together beyond. It's just not, I don't see it.
Totally agree. Back on topic. No, that was all of us. It was a group effort there. So they went in there with no backlog. They had, what movies did they have? They had that run, hide, fight or something like that. That looked interesting. Oh yeah, truth. Hell yeah.
I'm glad it's only my chest up.
So, fighting movie. They had that movie, which looked interesting, and then they had the one Gina Carano movie.
Gina Carano films, yeah. One of them looked okay. The other one was just a nothing burger.
They just looked like, hey, watch this movie because it has Gina Carano in it. You support Gina Carano, right? And it zero interest.
You need more than that. You need something real, not just. You need something more than f the system. You need more than that.
It's like their chocolate, right? And that feels like that's how they run all of their type of businesses. Is like they're like, Hershey's just insulted conservatives. Let's make a chocolate and we'll sell it to conservatives and grift off that. And it's like, no, just make a chocolate if you want to make chocolate. Don't just fucking make the conservative alternative to everything. Like,
right? So
stop.
At least Jeremy at the Quartering just made good coffee.
Yeah,
he doesn't make coffee. He goes through third party like they
all. Right. But he tries to. He wants his business to grow. I'll say that.
Well, that's fine. There's nothing wrong with like he's just using that as like his merch, right? Essentially,
why not?
If you support me, you know, support. This is a way to support me, right?
Says all the Daily Wire movies sucked. I saw all of them except for Western. With Gina, but he's seen all the others, and he said,
"That's what I hear." They're just focused on just getting the content out there. I don't even know. No, it's just
putting message before story.
Yeah,
which is what AC, you and I have talked about this for hours, but that's the main problem with the mainstream media. They're putting message before story,
right?
Almost and every time in every movie.
Well, propaganda arguably is not art, right?
Right, it can be well done.
I think you could have like clever messaging hidden in movies for sure.
Right,
even good movies. But
I mean,
then there's a line when it becomes just straight up propaganda.
Right,
I think.
Right,
I think
when we define propaganda, we mean the extreme harmful, manipulative. When you're in that red line zone, right?
Well, that's what you're talking about, because before it was like is a little bit up to interpretation when we were younger, but now it's so blatant. It's not clever. Yeah. It's not hidden.
Yeah.
It's just in your face.
Well, there were some like left wing messages and a lot of those stuff that we really liked, but it was just a few like messages here and there. And also they were not like, right. But they were also not like super spicy like messages either. But the thing is, the stories were just really good, and you don't care.
Like, the product was still viable without that. That's the thing.
Yeah, I don't know. Can you think of one off the top of your head that was like obviously like left wing, but you still bang? Star Trek.
It's all about diversity, equality. Yeah, dude. It's all there.
Now, I am from a Star Trek disliker point of view, but a lot of people liked it, and it was definitely left wing messaging, especially the early stuff.
Interesting.
In my opinion.
Interesting.
It's like, you know when that kind of tripped my brain out for a while when I started getting older, I was like, Robin Hood, all the Robin Hood stories. It took me a minute.
Robin Hood's not left wing, bro.
I know he's not, but it tripped me up for a little bit when I was younger because I was trying to figure it out in my head. I'm like, well, he's stealing from the rich and giving to the poor. What's the difference?
He's not stealing from the rich. That is left wing propaganda.
That's stealing propaganda. See, that's where it goes.
That's us.
He's stealing the tax money back from the government and giving it back to the people who pay the taxes.
I know.
He was not stealing from the rich.
Think about the phrase that people used.
I know, but that's not the content. Co-opted. That's the propaganda. That's the psyop. Yeah, that's gaslighting. Yeah. Like that's like they try to like the same thing that they try to do with X-Men, being like X-Men was always about race. And like, no, fuck, it wasn't.
Right.
I love that line from Teen Titans. Like Starfire was feeling insecure and discriminated against, and she looks over at Cyborg. She's like, "Do you know what it's like to be treated differently just for the way you look?" He's like, "Yeah, of course I do. I'm a robot." Yes.
Right.
Oh, I love that. Yeah. I love that.
Of course I do. I'm a robot. I got another one for you. I got another one. Star Wars. Think about it.
What do you mean?
There's a whole bunch of diverse. There's a whole bunch of diverse races.
So here's the thing: diversity is not my point.
No, and I'm thinking about,
especially when it's aliens too.
Hold on. You look at George Lucas's history and relationship with Steven Spielberg, and like kind of what they were into at the time. They were kind of left leaning hippies, and furthermore, you can they're old school. They're old school liberal is what I'm getting at. And when you get at the heart of their stories, think about it. There's rebellion. It's about a rebellion against a tyrannical empire. Original.
Look, America was built as a rebellion, man. That's not.
Oh, I'm not saying America. I'm just saying general communistic, but not quite communistic yet. Because he's American.
No, that's not a. So that's where it's like. So it is.
The emperor politics was born out of a Senate, like a basically kind of what America was. But it was born. Yeah. It was a transfiguration from a representative republic.
Yeah.
Into the Galactic Empire, which is, I think, kind of the fear of George Lucas after witnessing. Right. The Patriot Act and the Bush stuff.
I believe it.
True. I'll take that. Yeah, but I'm just saying.
I'm just saying a little
rebellion against a tyrannical government is not. It's neither side. That is a centrist.
Because we should all be aware of it. Like, think of the Second Amendment. It's there for partially for tyrannical governments. So I won't say that's entirely a left leaning thing. But
that's what
I'm saying. When we look at the left leaning meme that is. In storytelling, it's prevailing in everything. It's in storytelling is the rebellion arc.
The current issue, right? Yeah. And that's where it's like current day politics, because they're relating it to current day politics instead of something that's politics in a story that's not like to be like specific messaging about it's current all politics.
Allegorical.
Yeah, that's like the really annoying thing when you're like, hey, keep politics out of storytelling. And people are like, there's always been politics and storytelling. And we're like, not like this.
Not
current day.
Not where it's just a propaganda war. Let's be fucking real.
Also, it's real quick, because I'm watching the chat, Animated Moon has joined us, and he and Evely are shooting the shit in the chat. But he brought up another one. He says, Metropolis is technically inspired by the socialist rise in Germany happening in the early turn of the century. Still my favorite movie. I can't say I've seen Metropolis. Have you guys seen it?
I know it's a classic, but it's like on my list.
I think he and I probably won't get to, but I still have yet to watch it.
Is that the anime? The Metropolis? Isn't there Metropolis anime?
Animated Moon is Metropolis. Is that live action or animated? They're talking about special effects.
I think there's two.
There might be more than one.
Watch party. Yeah. But back to the conservative Dailywire specifically.
LGF.
Live action. They both say live action. Okay. Live action, not the anime. Yeah. Says the animated moon.
I just don't understand where it's like when you're because the Dailywire it's small comparatively to the mainstream stuff, and when you're talking about making cultural impact, it's like why go straight to the movies? Again, you can. Start small, like books and comic books. When you can have, they should have been a publisher, right? They should have just been like, okay, let's publish stuff that's not apolitical, right? And just has good stories, and that way that people can come to us and be the alternative to.
They could also those literary sell agents. Political books because a lot of the people on their on their ballot are politically motivated people. And so also do that. It would be a lot smarter way to go about it.
And I think they already do that, but it's just that the stories, like the fiction stories, that's what's going to drive the culture. You know what I mean? They're self-helpish, like philosophical story, like books aren't really going to push culture.
You could furthermore, you could just put good storytelling at the forefront of your new small business agenda. And essentially take whatever extra profits and incorporate it into your growth model that you will be donating to whatever political party that you support. You can do all that behind the scenes and separate the work from the art. And I will add that, like, every single artist and writer and human being has preferences, beliefs, ideas, things that shape who they are. And there's also just universal truths about the world. So each of us can't help.
Good story, they will come out one way or another.
It'll just happen. Like, the sky is blue. You know what I mean? Gravity exists. Like, there's certain things that just will come out in good stories. Totally. And there's ways you can tell the things. There's things that you could. There's ways that you could tell your political talking points in a good neutral story where it still is supporting what you believe in. Like, for example. Let's break down a very simplistic idea, okay? Left versus right, okay? Political. One side is anti-family, right? Quote unquote. The other side is pro-family, quote unquote. We'll just say pro-choice abortion, whatever. You can have simply stories that are strong and about family. Because if they're strong, they will sell. People will love good stories. And if they're about family, they support what you're about. So there you go. And then you can always incorporate what I said into the business model and donate to your political party behind the scene. But there's no reason to force feed people anything. And there's no reason to guilt yourself into thinking you need a third party consultant firm to tell you that your story is not good enough according to them, because they went to some bumfuck college in the middle of nowhere and spent all their money on a degree that's worthless now. So they need everybody to think the way that they do. Otherwise, they're out of the job.
It's like, can I give an example real quick? Like, in recent stuff, like, if you do good storytelling, people will forgive a lot. Like, I watched a portion of
Bad animation.
But I watched a portion of the TV show for of The Last of Us recently, and there's a whole episode that's the entire episode is focused about on this gay relationship and the how it developed over time. And it still does make me uncomfortable to a degree. I understand it. It wasn't my favorite episode, but people still really liked that episode because there was genuine care. Like, it wasn't that we're gay and get over it. Kind of, that's not what they were doing episode. There was an actual story there. And so even people like me who don't enjoy that as much in their stories, they were very forgiving of that because the storytelling was really, really solid.
Exactly. Yeah, every you was put a awesome, good story. Yeah. You can almost put anything into a story. You can check all those same diversity boxes and have like a strong, like female of color as the protagonist, and just have a good story, and everybody will come to it.
So I didn't watch The Last of Us show.
You need to phrase that differently, son.
Yeah.
I didn't watch The Last of Us really show. Hard. But to the. My one question about that episode, and I've heard a lot of praise for it. I'm sure it's good, but did that help the overall story at all, or is it just like a good episode on its own?
It could.
That's a waste of time.
It didn't have to be a dude. It could have been a woman, and it wouldn't have really. Yeah. It would not have made any difference.
Well, I meant like the overall story of Last of Us, like, because it wasn't that very contained episode.
It did play in, but it did add context and add. It did add to the loss.
World building. It's
the people.
Okay.
So it's kind of like world building. Yeah.
Character development also. If you're talking. Yeah. Okay. Let me follow. Are you talking about the gay episode of The Last of Us?
Yeah.
Is that what you're talking about? Okay. Exposition, world building, and character development.
No. Yeah. If it does a little bit of world building, then it's worth it. Like, it just has to.
Yeah.
Play some part in the overall story.
Do something. Yeah.
Hey, if I was the Dailywire, I'll end the Dailywire subject on this. Why are they not like doing whatever they can or some kind of psyop into Brandon Sanderson, who's a Mormon? Like,
yeah, he's values like, family. Mormon. Yeah.
Yeah.
And he I'm like, dude, family. Get him. Like, if you got him, there's no way that you're not successful. Even if it's like one book.
I think the other thing about Sanderson is he plays ball a lot with what's been happening.
Even some smaller, like there's this YouTuber I used to talk with a lot.
Yeah, did you watch
a little bit?
Yeah, she
did you read the fourth
quite a bit?
Did you read the fourth Stormlight Archive book?
Yeah, dude.
So it was the worst.
He sounded excited.
Yeah,
but it was definitely his worst. So many other books out there.
Yeah, but like you did catch a little bit of the hints of, you know, some social current day stuff, like the sprites have more, we have more than two genders. And it was such an eye roll. It was like, okay, which one of your fucking
beggars made that suggestion? I think it's because, like, for that, like, it didn't have really an impact on the story. It was like I know the line you're talking about. They're like, oh, well, those Spren were not conceived by humans, therefore they don't conform to the same gender norms as humans do. Yeah. And it was like a throwaway line that was never breached or talked about again.
Right, but it makes me think, because I'm like, and I could be wrong, but it's like, okay, this is also coincidentally his worst book that I've read. So I'm like, is there a correlation, right?
I have a few theories in regards to that. I think, and he even talked about it. Part of it was that the you know how each Stormlight book has a large portion of it dedicated to the flashbacks of a single character. The flashbacks.
Oh, I agree with this.
They did not land the way that they should have in the fourth book.
Bad. Yeah.
And it was mostly like going back in Venli's past, and that, and because they already kind of did that, they already showed the Parshendi perspective in the first book a little bit. And even in the second book, I'm like,
they were going over stuff we already knew.
It feels like we're retracking kind of old stuff a little bit. And then Kaladin had a little bit of a regression in regards to it. I understand why, but all of these elements kind of came together in a weird way. But then like there were things about the fourth Stormlight that I loved. Navani. I love her portions with her and, oh, the Parshendi woman. What's her name?
Is that, like, the mother? No.
That is the mother.
I like the first half. The first half, because it was mainly like her book, and I love the science. Like going into the science, I was like, dude, this is, honestly, the first half of that fourth book, I was like, this might be my favorite one.
And then I was feeling similarly. Yeah.
Like he does do this thing where he has a twist, and I won't ruin the twist, but he'll sometimes he has twists, and he'll hint it like to death. And sometimes it crosses a point and you're just like, dude, like you literally have to have only two brain cells to not get this twist at this point.
That being said, sometimes he'll get me. Very
Which
rarely.
Is handholding.
Oh. Sometimes.
Oh, man.
That's handholding though, right?
What was that?
It's two handholding. And there is this thing because he has a philosophy where spoiling a story, there's tests and studies to back this up, that if you spoil a story to somebody, they actually are more likely to enjoy it.
Yeah,
I understand the data. I hate it. Royce and I were arguing about this either. I have a whole script about a video written for it. It's going to be a thing. I'm not going to argue against the science. I'm just going to talk about my personal reasons why I'd rather not be spoiled on a story that I actually care about. But anyway, yeah.
So I agree that, like, kind of both points, right? So like, If you got a really good twist, I don't want that spoiled. But then again, like, if I do know the twist, I know I'm gonna like it, and I will still enjoy it. So maybe I worded some of my things wrong. But Berserk, I actually had Berserk spoiled for me. In the beginning. And actually, Berserk spoils itself in the beginning, because right off the bat,
a major point.
So the whole time you're on the edge of your feet. And you're like, how does this happen? Now, the twist is you never could guess the direction it goes to.
Well, that's also a little bit of a Japanese storytelling convention, too. They'll show the future, and then the most of the story is technically a flashback. I've seen it happen in a lot of Japanese storytelling. You guys talk for a second. I'm dying.
So a little bit of that water in here.
I was going to say, we should probably look, man, the eye and the earth. I need to see it.
Anyway. We should probably end this actually. We're an hour and a half.
I'm good for that. Yeah.
But I was going to say real quick. Yeah. The eclipse, my roommate was watching it, and I literally see it on the screen, and I'm like, Gonzo, I'm like, what is this? Fuck, are you watching? And he's like, oh, it's Berserk. I'm like,
it's so much porn.
That looks sick. Awesome, right? And then I watched it. I was like, holy shit, this is the best thing I ever picked up. It goes from there. But all right, hey, yo, we actually had quite a bit of people stick around for this.
I can't see the numbers. Yeah, people hung out. It was a good time, man. Especially, like, you're still growing your channel, too. This is great. Yeah.
Yeah. So, also, next week,
if any of you aren't subscribed, I will find you.
And I will kill you. On my show, usually I won't do this, but you know, as you can see, I'm driving the short bus today, as I'm always driving it on this channel.
As one does. So,
oh, that hurt
join,
my eyes. Holy crap.
Join me on my short bus in this venture, because you are retarded because you've been watching this, and it's a truth, as Pritchard has been saying. We all are actually retarded. It's just coming to the realization
every of every single one of us. So, join us on the Iron Seas. We're driving a bus on the ocean. There's nothing that can go wrong.
So hey guys, subscribe to all of our channels, because what we're doing, and this might be really stupid, I just admitted I'm retarded, but we'll see if it works out. Hopefully it does. We're cycling the channel through all of our the show through all of our channels. Next week we're doing the Ultimate Kahuna, so the show is going to be on his channel, and then obviously the week after that it's going to be Pritchard. It's not always going to be, because if we have something coming up or something going on, we might not be able to host it. So follow us on Twitter.
Some of us are very popular and may not always be there, but that's okay.
Yeah.
It's all right, guys.
So, yeah, I'm Battsauce on everything. Check the description. It has all of our links to everything. My book, the audiobook, it's on my Substack. It's free to listen to. It's a really long. It's pretty long. I got a lot of pages here. It's like over 300 pages. Pretty something long. Like that.
Really pretty impressive.
Impressive. The second book will come out. Probably next year, hopefully. But all right, that's all I'm going to plug. Kahuna, you got anything to say before we sign off?
I have a great many things to say. Thank you for being here and enjoying this content with us. Disgusting stories, making fun of the mainstream, and taking really unethical bad quizzes. You can find me at The Ultimate Kahuna YouTube and X, or Twix, whatever you want to call it. Check out Battsauce's YouTube channel. It's freaking awesome. Check out A.C. Pritchard. He has a book as well as his own YouTube channel in the form of Pritchard Pub. Thank you for being here. Woo!
Anyway, guys, that's all I got. Sorry.
What an honor.
All right. How do you AC, what you got going on?
I don't even know how you follow that. Yeah, follow me on...
I'm in like half-mast. I'm pretty excited. Sorry.
Yeah, I know. At @A_C_Pritchard, that goes for basically all socials. You can find me on Instagram and all that. You can go to acpritchard.substack.com right there and read some free fantasy spirit animals. I'm loving it. It's taking on a life of its own. The next episode, once I'm done, is going to be voiced by that man right there. Yes. Yeah. The Turtle Lord himself. Doing the voice of Miyoku Okea.
I'm supposed to be the retarded one on this show.
That's amazing.
You don't know me, brother. Right. I grew up homeschooled.
And as we end this show, we all agreed we're going to sing Come Sail Away by Styx. Greatest band Come ever. Come Sail Away. No, I'm just kidding. All right, fuck off. Later, guys.
Yeah.
Bow with the bow, the bang, the dang, dig, 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 dig. Set the boogie, sit up, jump the boogie. Bow with the bow, the bang, the dang, dang, diggy, diggy, dig. Set the boogie, sit up, jump the boogie. Bow with the bow, the bang, the dang, dig, dig, dig. Set the boogie, sit up, jump the boogie. Bow with a bow, the bang, the dang, dang, diggy, diggy, dick, set the boogie, sit up, jump the boogie. My name is Bob.